Hallelujah.
Christ is born. Glory to God in the highest. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. Rejoice and be of good cheer. Deck the halls and don your gay apparel and ring those jingle bells. Celebrate. For on this night God has come to us. God Most High has come down low to visit us in the flesh, with salvation for all, to establish peace on earth and goodwill among all people. It is a glorious day to celebrate, indeed, a day worthy of breaking out your finest wines and cooking up your favorite foods, of singing festive songs and watching your favorite holiday movies, like Die Hard. I'm right. It is a celebration worthy of spending with your family, with your closest friends, and with total strangers, because the Christmas spirit makes a family of us all. It truly is the most wonderful time of the year. But while we are swept up in feasting and gift-giving and merriment, distracted by all the pretty lights, let us not forget how this all began. Let us remember where it all started 2,000 years ago, in a little town called Bethlehem, a little backwater, nowhere town in what would have been the ancient equivalent of flyover territory. To Mary and Joseph, an unwed peasant couple expecting a child conceived out of wedlock. Among witnesses of ill repute, shepherds, dirty and poor, who, unlike their sweet, idyllic portrayal on Hallmark cards, were actually a rather rough and tumble bunch, considered by most in their society to be shifty and untrustworthy. You know, the sort of folks you might cross the street to avoid. These are all of the most unexpected characters in the most unexpected setting, and yet this was the beginning of the drama of God's salvation for the world. Here is where God decided to take on flesh, to join himself to his creation in order to redeem it from sin and death. It is hard to overstate how radical this story was when it was first told. The Savior of the world, God incarnate, is conceived out of wedlock to a peasant girl. If you think there is a social stigma on unwed pregnancy today, it doesn't even come close to how offensive this was to first century Palestine. A woman caught pregnant out of wedlock could legally be stoned to death for committing adultery. This is why the gospel says that Joseph had planned to annul their marriage quietly and privately, so that Mary's life might be spared, although she and her bastard son would doubtless have spent the rest of their lives living as social outcasts. But God came to Joseph and asked him to do the unthinkable, to marry the woman who Joseph had every reason to believe had been unfaithful, to take on himself the social shame of raising a child everybody would know was not his. This was a great sacrifice for Joseph, one which took great courage, almost as much courage as that was asked of Mary. Mary, who was required to risk shame and destitution and even death in order to carry the Christ child. And yet she still said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your will." St. Luke sets up this story brilliantly. "In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered." Already from the beginning, this story is truly universal in scope. For the Roman Empire ruled the majority of the known world, and only the emperor was mighty enough to demand a census of every last person in it. That was one huge endeavor, and in predictable fashion of governments in all times and places, it was for the purpose of extracting more taxes from the people. And it is here, in the shadow of this mighty empire, that God decides to enter the world. You might have expected God Almighty, maker of the universe, to come as someone strong, powerful, to demonstrate his glory and his might for all the world to see but instead he shows up here in Bethlehem, in a peasant town, as the illegitimate child of a couple of nobodies. Born in a barn stall, laid in the feeding trough, wrapped in swaddling clothes. That means rags. How embarrassing. And who was granted the honor of being his first audience, the first to bend the knee and pay homage to the newborn king? Shepherds. Shepherds, as I mentioned, had a bad reputation for being shiftless, untrustworthy, and impious. They lived in the wilderness with sheep far away from things like baths, so they probably stunk. Like women and slaves, their testimony was not admissible in the court of law, and yet they are the ones Luke appeals to, their testimony being the first to witness the Christ child. Yes, this story was scandalous to all the first people who heard it. It remained scandalous for a great long time, and somewhere along the way, we managed to domesticate it with a pretty scene on a Hallmark card. But if we pause to contemplate it, it is still scandalous today. Because as you can see, God has a thing for choosing all the wrong kinds of people. Maybe you felt like all the wrong kinds of people before. Maybe you've struggled with feelings of insignificance or inadequacy. Maybe you've been shamed for things beyond your control or for mistakes you've made that you wish you could take back. Maybe you've been struggling at the bottom of the economic ladder and can never seem to grasp the next rung. The Christmas story is good news for you, because you're exactly the kind of person our God is in the habit of choosing to do great things in and through. This is good news, yet it is also a challenge, because each of us can think of some individual or some group that we consider all the wrong kinds of people, right? Take a moment and think. What sort of person would you write off instantly as untrustworthy, unimportant, or undesirable? The Christmas story is a challenge to you and to me to see those people with new eyes. Our modern American society treats a lot of people as undesirable and unimportant. Usual suspects are undocumented immigrants, refugees, asylum seekers, members of the LGBT community, those in nursing homes and the homebound, so easily overlooked, people struggling with addictions, people with mental illness, those in prison, ex-convicts, the poor and the homeless. So many people we are quick to leave behind and deem unimportant. But brothers and sisters, we who have heard the angels singing on high, we have a responsibility to stand in solidarity with all of society's nobodies, to embody God's redeeming love to them in word and in deed. We to whom the word of God incarnate has come, we who have been led to behold the Christ child laying in the manger, we now have the job of the Blessed Virgin Mother. We get to bear that incarnate word to testify that our God has come, and that he has come in the most unexpected of ways, the most unexpected of peoples. We are all the wrong kinds of people. We are all sinners, after all. Rich and poor alike, for the poor and the oppressed, the coming of our infant king means liberation, and for the rich and powerful, it means finding the salvation that comes with humility. For all, it means falling to our knees in awe of the fact that God Almighty would deign to come down to us, to take on our nature, and to truly come to know this broken but beautiful human experience firsthand. And it is our hope that as God took on our lot to share in our sufferings and so to overcome them, we might share in his glory and his everlasting life. So, may you encounter this surprising grace anew this Christmas, and may your celebrations be extra festive. For God's love has come to you, and it will empower you to be God's people, redeemed by God's grace, made new and empowered to do the work of sharing God's peace with all the earth. Thanks be to God.